This is the Moira steam engine, built sometime around 1800. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. So the Moira engine's a Newcomen-style atmospheric engine, and around 1800, it was already obsolete when it was built. Thing is, it worked at a coal mine, and if you work in a coal mine, the one thing you have lots of is waste coal. So that's what they burned in their boilers. And by burning waste coal, their fuel was effectively free. So rather than pay license fees for more expensive engines, they were simply able to use a far older engine design and use a little bit more fuel, but save money in the long run. The engine has a 33-inch diameter bore. You see it's open at the top, and you actually see the top of the cylinder head there. 51-inch stroke produced an estimated 10 horsepower at 15 RPM. To the left of the cylinder, you see the plug tree, the large vertical post running down right behind it. And the valve assemblies, and at the bottom you see the condenser tank. That tank is why it's believed this one might be the same manufacturer as the Dudley engine or the windmill end engine, because the design is awfully similar. This one has some extra features though. Let's take a look. So this is a dual purpose engine, and that's why you'll see some extra parts on it. If we focus from the cylinder to the right, it's a standard mine pump engine. Put steam into the bottom of the cylinder. The gravity from the weight of the shaft of the pump will pull the shaft down, pull the piston up. When it's full, you inject a little bit of cold water or open the valve to that box below it, and that causes the steam to condense, creating vacuum. Atmospheric pressure pushes the cylinder down, pushes the piston down, and pulls the pump shaft up. This is actually probably more or less how this engine started. So this engine probably started basically with that when it was built around 1800. Well, it probably started in the Moira furnaces, owned by the same person as the later colliery. And probably ran bellows, air pumping equipment, etc., which is perfect for a standard beam engine. Well, the furnaces shut down in 1819, and we know that this was placed at the Moira coal mine in 1821. And there was put to double duty, which explains the other side. In addition to pumping water from the mine after it was moved, as a standard beam engine, this was also used as a winding engine. It's called a whims or a whimsy or a hoist engine, which explains these extra components on this side. So in its new configuration, operating the cylinder actually operated both overhead beams simultaneously. The beam on the right operated the mine pump, which pumped water from the mine. The beam on the left, through the use of a heavily weighted crank, rotated the large flywheel through the gearing system, and that rotated these two large drums. The drums were used in the hoisting system, allowed for hoisting of men and equipment up and down, as well as the hoisting of coal up from the mine. And the reason there's some question about the age of this particular engine and its exact origin is that the cylinder is believed to be the oldest part and believed to have been made in the 1790s. That compares to the beam up here, which is a steel beam, which is stamped 1821. If you look at the beam on the pump side, that's a wooden beam. Would those have been put together on the same engine at the same time? Interestingly, the crank is also heavily weighted, which is something that you do with a single acting cylinder if you're not running a heavy pump shaft. The weight allows this end to be pulled back down. Without that, your piston wouldn't be able to operate. So it appears this was set up so it could run either as a pump or as a winding engine, or simultaneously as both. So the pump element here actually served double duty. The first thing it was used for, of course, was to pump water out of the coal mine. Flooded mines obviously are a continuous problem in 1800 as well as today. But that water wasn't just wasted. It was actually put into the Ashby Canal, which was constructed by the Earl of Moira, just like the furnace and later the colliery. And that canal was then used to ship coal from the coal mines. So we don't have any pictures of this in operation, unfortunately. We can tell how it worked. See the lever coming off the steam inlet pipe here. That allowed steam into the system. Above it, that geared mechanism with stuff going up and down, that operated the valves, both the inlet and the exhaust valve. The vertical rod next to it, with a large rectangular piece on the side, that's called a plug tree. Plug was another term for valve. And that rectangular piece would hit that hand lever that sticks out to actually operate the valves. As it pushes it down, it does one thing, lifts it up, does another. Looking from the other side, you'd see underneath you have the mechanism there that operates the valves for the exhaust, and that causes the valve to open up and the steam inside to condense, which allows the atmospheric pressure to push the piston down. And to the left, you see something that I've never seen on a steam engine before, which is that foot pedal. Taking a look and following that around, see first the lever's ratcheted, so if you push it down, it stays down. But that comes over underneath the deck and engages this flywheel. It appears it may actually engage into those holes on the flywheel, locking it in place. So if you push that lever down, the flywheel is locked in place, those drums do not turn. So while this is operating, the flywheel turns that gear nearest us, which turns the gear on the far side, which turns the shaft, rotating both of these drums. To the far left, you see a brake system. There's wooden brake pads. Brake shoes, I suppose, in this case. Pulling the lever through this mechanism down below, pulls the top pad down, pushes the bottom one up, and these heavy wooden pads are then pressed against the inner steel wheel, acting as a brake. It's this brake that actually failed in 1832. In September 1832, the brakeman working this system failed to pull that lever. The hoist kept turning. Car that should have stopped at ground level kept rising, went 32 feet up to the overhead tower, over the top of the pulley, and fell 32 feet, causing the death of two miners and serious injuries for eight others. The brakeman was charged, and mining operations continued. Life was a lot cheaper back in 1832. So the pumping system doesn't care which direction the drums are turning, but the hoist obviously does, and you have to change directions pretty frequently. That's why this system was actually set up to operate with one person, and you could manually operate the valves rather than using the plug tree. By manually operating it, that would allow you to bring it partway up on the cylinder and stop the piston. And then if you inject the cold water, that would pull the piston back down before it went over the top. That would effectively reverse the direction of the wheels and reverse the direction of the hoist. This would have been done over and over throughout the day. Looking at these wheels, you can see a lot of wear from centuries of use. The cables originally on this were probably hemp, probably replaced not too long after that with steel. Steel wasn't really available yet when the mine first opened. So on the left has considerably more wear than the one on the right. Having two drums, that gave them quite a bit of opportunity to vary their operation. You could counterwind the drums, as is commonly done today. Just wrap the cables in opposite directions so that while one car is going up, the other's always going down. You could use one, such as the one on the left, essentially as a capstan, while the one on the right operated more as a traditional hoist. And looking at the wear patterns on the wood, you might think that was the case, as one on the left has a whole lot more wear than the one on the right. Well, it may just be because they replaced the one on the right more. This mechanism in the middle reminds me a lot of a clutch. So if that is a clutch, you could operate the left wheel as a capstan, activating the brake on the wheel on the right would allow you to stop the wheel on the right and keep running the pump. Like I said, they had a lot of options available in exactly how they ran it. This was a fairly versatile setup. So in about 1900, they stopped using this as a winding engine, and it was just purely run as a pump from that point on. It ran as a pump until 1929, when a buyer for Henry Ford went and located it and expressed interest. At the time, he thought this actually dated to the late 1800s, not the early 1800s, late 1700s, but further research has shown otherwise. In any case, it was still working when it was purchased. It was moved here to Henry Ford Museum in Dearborn, Michigan, and demonstrates this incredible technology and the versatility of these systems. That's why this is the Industrial Revolution. Before you go, I do need your help. There's two things you can do. Number one is help YouTube get more people to the channel. Easiest way you can do that, completely free, hit like on the video, subscribe to the channel, and best of all, you can comment more than just two or three words. That tells YouTube, you know, this video is good, the channel's good, send more people here. Second thing you can do, each of these videos ends up being pretty expensive to actually produce. Obviously, it's hours of work for each one, but I also have to actually drive to the locations. And if it's far enough away, I have to spend a night in order to do all the on-location filming that I do for these videos, that I think is essential for the videos. If you can help out financially, either with a super thanks, or if you can help out over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution, that'll help me to extend my range even further, get out to more and better sites, and bring you even better videos. Thanks for watching. Look forward to seeing you next time.